Hi, I'm Jimmy. In this video, we're going to look at the fact that interest rates, specifically the 10-year treasury rate, have jumped fairly quickly, a decent amount over the past month or two. We're going to look at what this could mean for the stock market, and hopefully we can use this information to help us make more informed investment decisions and ideally get us closer to our goal of achieving financial freedom. Okay, so let's jump right in. So the most logical place to start is to look at the discount rate. So this is a chart of the discount rate. This is set by the Federal Reserve. So back when COVID really started to ramp up and really started to hurt the economy, the first thing that the Federal Reserve did was to drop interest rates to try to help spur along the economy, or at least keep the economy moving. Now, the point of cutting interest rates is, one, it makes borrowing money cheaper, and that tends to help the economy. And two, it encourages more spending. So of course, both of these are good drivers to help the economy stay positive and not really go into a recession, or at least not as bad of a recession. Now, we should remember that although this drop, just as one example, in the discount rate very quickly gets priced into the stock market. We saw that with the stock market. Stock market started moving higher last year, long before the economy did anything to get any better. So the stock market tends to react very quickly to this type of move. But generally, it's accepted that by most economists that it takes about a year for the broader economy to really react to a increase or a decrease in interest rates, which is by coincidence right about now. Now, just so we're all on the same page as far as the discount rate is concerned, well, this is the interest rate that banks can borrow from the Federal Reserve on an overnight basis. And the discount rate is crucial since many other interest rates, they're sort of tied. They're not officially tied, but they move up and down based on what the discount rate is doing. Okay, now this brings us to the 10-year treasury interest rate. So this is a chart of the 10-year treasury rate. And as we can see, back when COVID first started happening and the Federal Reserve dropped the discount rate, well, we can see that this rate was also impacted by that, which makes a ton of sense. But we may have noticed that with the discount rate, well, they dropped it lower and it's been at that same spot ever since. Yet with the 10-year treasury rate, well, the treasury rate coming off of the bottom from a few months ago, well, the rate has tripled, more than tripled, since it hit the bottom. So our question is now, what does this mean for the stock market? Now, one point for us to consider is that generally rising interest rates should favor the financial sector. So if you own bank stocks or, you know, financial stocks in general, you might have noticed that year to date, they're probably doing fairly well, especially when long-term rates, like the 10-year rate, is moving up at a faster rate than short-term rates, because banks and many financial companies make money on the spread. They borrow at short-term rates, they lend out at long-term rates. So if you own any of those stocks, you might have seen them been doing fairly well recently. This also explains why something like the Spider Financial Sector ETF is up about 14% year-to-date, even though the S&P 500 is only up about 5%. So financial stocks can do well. Technology stocks tend to do not as well when interest rates are rising. So that would explain, at least partially, why technology stocks have struggled a bit more this year. Specifically last month, past few weeks, you might have seen some volatility and some pullback in some tech stocks. This is one of the key reasons why. Now, there are a couple other considerations that could really impact the level of the stock market, whether or not the stock market moves up or down, if interest rates continue to rise, or even if they stay up at this level. And first, and probably the simplest one, is how many stocks are valued. Here's what I mean. So this is a recent discounted free cash flow calculation that I had done on a video. I created a video on Lockheed Martin, and I actually personally bought that stock after doing my analysis and creating the video. But the important point here is that our required rate of return for this analysis was 7.5%. And we saw that the fair value for the stock was about $493 per share. But this required rate of return is crucial as to how this whole calculation works. The higher our required rate of return is, the more we require to get back from our investment, well, the lower the price we should pay. Probably logical. So if we were to increase this required rate of return from 7.5% up just 1% to 8.5%, well, the fair value of this stock drops down to $411 per share. Now, personally, I've actually kept my required rate of return constant over the past year to try to keep some consistency in the videos that I do. But many, many investors, in fact, if you went to school for any of this stuff, they probably taught you to use something like the weighted average cost of capital. That's what I always learned to use. And in that is something known as the capital asset pricing model. It's a basically a way to come up with the required rate of return for each company. And by the way, if you're not sure what I'm talking about as far as this whole calculation is concerned, it's actually less important for this specific topic. I did a few videos on how to do this. So if you're curious to learn how to do this, I'll leave a link to those videos in the description below. But basically, here's the important point. Something like the capital asset pricing model. How have we come up with our required rate of return? Well, this is the formula for the capital asset pricing model. Just know that this is one of the ways building up to coming up with a required rate of return. Well, one of the most important numbers in this calculation is, it shows up twice here, is the risk-free rate. What is the most popular risk-free rate number to use? You guessed it, the 10-year US Treasury yield. So when we go back to the chart here, this jump by 1% in the 10-year Treasury significantly affects a lot of valuations. If we were using the capital asset pricing model to come up with our required rate of return, well, just like that, our required rate of return would be higher. And because of that, the natural fair value of stocks would be lower. That would be one reason that stocks should not move higher. So if interest rates stay up at this level, well, it's very possible that the stock market moves lower. Even if it doesn't move lower, it's possible that it just sort of teeters off and doesn't go anywhere. Maybe it just moves sideways for a while. Now, another angle to this, like I mentioned before, the level of interest rates affects the broader economy, even though that can take time. But one example of that is for individuals, something like credit cards or mortgages or loans, especially if those loans have variable interest rates, if it's not like a fixed rate, if you have a variable mortgage or a variable loan, well, oftentimes they're tied to, if not the 10-year Treasury, it'll probably be something like that. So with this rate going higher, well, the average payment would also go higher. Now, this also goes back to why it takes some time, why it takes, on average, let's say, about a year to have a real impact on the economy. And that's because if you were getting a mortgage, you just got it a few months ago, well, you're very unlikely to need another mortgage right away. And the people that are coming in with higher rates, it takes time for all this stuff to filter through. It's not like they change the interest rate right away on everything that you do. Many times there's reset periods, especially for variable loans. Either way, this will take a little bit of time, but if it stays here, that could be a real problem. Now, that's true for individuals, but it's also true for companies. So one way that higher rates could hurt a company is, in theory, would lower their earnings. So at the most basic level, many companies have bonds. They issue bonds, and those bonds, generally, they're fixed bonds. Most of them are, at least, but they renew those bonds. So when debt becomes due, a lot of times they'll take out a new bond, they'll pay off the old bond, and just like that, they're stuck with a new rate. That hasn't been a problem because rates have been so low. But if rates go up, well, that increases the company's expenses because now they'll have higher interest payments, which lower their profits, which again could hurt the overall stock or hurt the overall stock price. So of course, higher interest rates could lead to higher payments, which could lead to lower profits. And I think that this is fairly logical and probably fairly obvious. But there are a few other considerations when it comes to analyzing a company as far as what industries might be affected from the change in interest rates. So like I said before, banks and many financial companies tend to do well. They make money with the spread. So as this spread widens, short-term rates stay low, long-term rates go up, financial companies can do very well. Now, on top of that, generally, commodities do well when interest rates rise as well. Now, this isn't true all across the board, not every time at least. Sure, something like gold and silver, well, both of those have dropped in this current situation. Yet, year to date, aluminum prices are up about 14%. Copper's up about 15%. Corn is up, I think, about 14% as well. Cattle, cotton, soybeans, all up. I think they're up single-digit numbers. Steel rebar is up about 12%. So it's not all across the board, but a large amount of commodities are higher in price. Now, I bring this out because this can have a giant impact and is often more overlooked than something like interest expenses would be for bonds with rising interest rates. Because if commodity prices go up, well, many companies use commodities to create their products. So if commodity prices go up, their expenses go up, and that could lead to lower profits, assuming, of course, the company can't increase their prices. So interest rates going up is something we're going to want to watch when we're analyzing different companies, trying to find great investments. And we're going to want to be aware of what their input costs are so we can have a better idea of how that company might be affected over the long run if interest rates eventually go up, and surely they will at some point. And then we can use that information to better understand the companies that we analyze and hopefully make better investment decisions. Now, we might hear this and think, okay, great, this is fantastic. Interest rates are going up, which seems like it could hurt things, at least in the near term. But when it comes to analyzing the companies, well, where do we start? Well, I actually did a video where I go through 8 steps to analyze a stock. So if you're curious how to analyze a company, perhaps that's a good next video for you to watch. I got a link right here. I got a link in the description below. And thank you so much for sticking with me all the way to the end of the video. I really appreciate it. Thank you, and I'll see you in the next video.